in this rather depressed, negative moment we're all going through in Lebanon, in the region, creating something that is not just for the moment, but that is timeless for Beirut. This is a gate of Beirut. This will be high visibility, do something that is meaningful, pertinent to the place, to its history, and that would last. So it's an intersection of many, many things put together to create a building that I think should have the elegance, the simplicity, and the lasting power.
It's a city with just so many stories, and I hope that our bank design actually will tell a new story, and will be a new story for the bank, almost bringing it, not erasing its identity, but giving it a new chapter in its life.
The building is not only about solving a functionality, it's actually about interpreting a way of living and a way of thinking.
It's really an epicenter of complexity, which is, I think, also the spirit of the city. And complexity and energy and beauty all together.
I hope that with this project we can discover it and we try to make a project based on this character, this atmosphere. Very unique and very diverse and very special of the city of Beirut.
التاريخ اللي اللي محيط بهذه الأرض لحاله بيخلينا نحلم ولما نحلم كيف بدنا نعمل كيف بدنا نتخيل هالمشروع تيرجع يعطي لبيروت اللي خسرته على كل هالمراحل كل هالأوقات.
You have to integrate or how to make a place for people, not only for the airport but for the city, because it's a very important location. I can consider in all the public time. So this is something that we would really like to focus on.
The way this initiative has been set up, fantastic architects invited. The whole group of us, it doesn't even feel like a competition anymore, you know? It just feels like being amongst friends. So I think it's the right way of dealing with things, it's the right way of organizing something, and it's the right way of moving forward when it comes to architecture. Mm-hmm. Architecture never happens in a vacuum.
Welcome everybody. It's a delight to see such a full house tonight, not to mention those outside that are attending through the BLF TV. I'm Raphaël Nahas, General Manager of Banque Libano-Française. As you probably know now, BLF launched an international competition back in 2015 to build its new headquarters in a plot at the northern main entrance of Beirut. Facing the sea and the port from one side, the iconic landmark of Electricité de Liban from the other, and the vibrant neighborhood of Malm Khayel on the back, this strategic site will place our bank in the heart of the economic and artistic development of the city. Banque Libano-Française witnessed a very important growth during the last 12 years, multiplying its balance sheet by 4 and its workforce by 2, and we are committed to keep on growing despite a very challenging environment. Today, we need a workplace to accompany our development and showcase our vision for the future in line with our history and the legacy of our late founder, Farid Raphael. We want an environment that reflects our values, serves our customers in the best way, welcomes the public, and becomes a second home that constantly triggers innovation, productivity, and interaction among our employees. We believe architecture can shape the behavior and create great experiences to the BLF community as well as the neighborhood community. We want our headquarters to be a powerful urban actor to improve the area and make the difference in the contemporary city condition. We are looking for a coherent ecological approach and a green label building. Most of all, our aim in this project is to set a new standard on how to approach the design of a building in Beirut by not only taking into consideration the private needs of the developers, but also the urban impact of the project, the necessity to include public spaces, enabling interaction with the surrounding community, and the absolute need to consider sustainability. To achieve our ambitions, we embarked on an exceptional and passionate venture together with Italian architect and curator Luca Molinari. The moderator of your conference tonight, which I would like to greatly thank for his exceptional dedication. With Luca, we started to search for candidates to take part in this competition. We chose 35 well-known local and international architects, as well as emerging talents. And we traveled from a city to another to meet each one in their own office, prior to shortlisting 8 studios, all present with us tonight. Thank you. We have Danish-American big Bjarke Ingels group. Italian-Spanish Barozzi Veiga. Thank you, Fabrizio. British Farshid Moussavi. Okay, Japanese Kengo Kuma. Let's say. Kengo is arriving tomorrow, but Marc, where is Marc? Marc Moukarzel is representing him. Italian Piuarch. Norwegian American Snøhetta. And last but not least, Lebanese Nabil Gholam. And Lebanese Youssef, Tohme. These remarkable architects were invited to Beirut for a 3-day introductory workshop in January to get to know the bank, its identity and its needs, as well as the city, the people and the site of the project. They are back today to showcase their works in front of the jury of the competition, involving BLF Chairman and General Manager Walid Rafael, Luca Molinari, Hashim Serkis, Dean of MIT Architecture School, whom Lebanon is so proud of, Jean-Christophe Romantin, Member of the French Parliament and Mayor of Neuilly-sur-Seine, as well as Li Zan, Professor in Beijing and Editor-in-Chief of World Architecture Magazine. Well, and myself. Four of the 8 architects presented their exceptional projects to us today. The 4 others will do so tomorrow. So don't chase for any announcement tonight regarding the winner. I will leave now the floor to those you are impatiently waiting for. BLF is tremendously happy and honored to share with all of you the privilege of meeting and discussing with all these beautiful talents. Thank you.
So, wow. I'm Luca Molinari, and tonight it's a unique situation for Beirut, as for any important city in the world, I think, having together here so many brilliant and fantastic designers on the same table. I think we are very lucky. We must thank Ryan, Walid, and BLF for this opportunity, and I think it's beautiful that inviting privately, the designer for the competition is fantastic that we bring them in public to discuss with you about the city, about Beirut, because this is not only a project for BLF, but this is a city, is a project for Beirut. And all the designers, some for me in this moment, are some of the best designers of the contemporary scene, brilliant, experimental, open-minded, and I'm sure that some of them will be some of the future Pritzker Prize. So, no one touch wood, please. So it's a challenge because architects has been invited by BLF to work in Beirut to design a new building which will represent something different for most of the recent architecture built in town. A building for Beirut, for my Michael, able to create architecture which will be a great place to work and at the same time a space open to the public and to the community. A space able to represent a possibility that private building, a bank headquarters, can be at the same time a sustainable place, able to change enrich the city to host culture, quality of life, and different social experiences. This is the real challenge, I think. So we will take the profit of the presence of our friend to discuss for a short time with you of this city. So no one asking about the project, they will not talk anything, it's a secret. But we are here to talk about Beirut and what does it means designing quality for a community and its future. The role of architecture is fundamental. It has the power to improve the quality of daily life, of the daily environment. And it is for this reason that there's a great responsibility. And I'm sure that Beirut, with all these great contradictions, could be considered today as a challenging urban and social laboratory for the future. That's why we are here. So my idea, we don't have so much time, and we are not experts of Beirut, but in a way we use Beirut, they use Beirut to design something which is something for the city, for BLF. So I will do very simple questions. You can give your comment, and we will take a time, and then we will ask our friends here to give you all some questions. But I would like to start with my first question. What Beirut gave you, and which influenced your design process? I mean, you arrived here 3 months ago, and you spent here 3 days, and then you came back home to your offices, and I'm sure that you have been digesting what you have seen, materials, the impressions, and not only. So, and every project you design is different because it's related to the place. We chose also you for this reason. So how Beirut enter in your project? What are the qualities of Beirut which enter in your design process? So who want to start? So I wouldn't say not the Lebanese because it can be very dangerous. So I start with Bjarke, please. Can you tell us something that you spent here the last days and?
I think one thing that that definitely strikes you when you come and visit Beirut for the first time is the sort of extreme hospitality. I think it's very rare that you end up on a first meeting. I think we ended up sort of deeply entrenched in some kind of a dinner with the sort of Beirut intelligentsia that then sort of lasted until 6 a.m. in the morning with the open roof at the Bernard Kouris sort of underground nightclub. So there is that. And then I think also like just on a first walk through. And what I mean maybe by that extreme hospitality is that that I think if there was a city where a building like an office or a bank headquarters could actually have a meaningful interaction with the public realm, it would probably be here. I could imagine a lot of cities where a bank would not want to be you know, as welcoming and inviting, but rather be about security and sort of enclosure. And then I think secondly, maybe Beirut has something. I mean, of course, Beirut has one of the nicest climates in the world. That's also an obvious thing to feel. And then I think maybe the apparent contrast as you walk around, you walk down like a really beautiful boulevard, and then the entire boulevard is cut off by barbed wire. In amounts that I've never seen before, and we were walking up this beautiful stair, and there's like these like sunken ruins, and the stair goes up to some kind of official-looking building, and then somebody has just put a lot of steel brackets against block it off. So like this feeling of you know the evidence of unrest is also very much there, and of course like a few buildings with some pretty big holes in them. Some of them architectural and some of them sort of heritage. So, there's obviously a lot to work with.
So, I'm sure there's a lot to work with. And, let's keep on going. I'm very interested about the qualities of the city, how the qualities of the city, the hidden and also the evident qualities of, can enter in the design process, how can influence it. Francesco Fresa by Piuarch,
I must say that actually our impression from Beirut was quite difficult. I mean, to understand this at the first moment, Beirut it's a very easy city. You arrive here, you have this. We had the same feeling. What you were saying, that it's a very welcome place, very open, and which is it is by fact. But you need some after a while. You understand the complexity of the city. I mean, the complexity of the culture, and which is something that we as Italian understand very well, because also our country is a mix of different culture, of different influences. So this characteristic actually made it even more interesting to get into the different aspects, which you can relate physically also in the city. I mean, moving around the city, you feel the different areas with different influences. So that is for sure a great stimulation for doing a project, especially if you believe that when you do a project nowadays, you have really to understand first the place and try to do something which is very related to the context. We have more and more the situation that we see architecture which is kind of coming from the space. Like you have nice building which are planned in some areas.
Like UFOs.
Like UFOs, yes. Well, like beautiful UFOs. I mean, I'm not saying that this architecture, sometimes I like it very much, but as I said, in Italy, our culture is somehow always to find an architecture which is kind of related to the place where you live, where you are. So and that Beirut gives you, from this point of view, a lot of energy on that. So, what was your question again?
I mean, which are the places, the building, or the feelings you have from this city, which were entering your design process, doing your proposal, without telling anything about your proposal? For sure.
Of course, yeah. Well, I wouldn't say any specific building. For sure, I think the architecture of the modernism really influenced us a lot, because you can definitely see the changes of the city to in the 60s, where it was really the great period where the city have a big changes. That here we have the chance to see very interesting buildings from this period, rather than from the post-war period. You feel you understand the kind of a quick development with some mess, I would say. I mean, I'm coming from Italy, it's the capital of mess, so we are very used with that. What really impresses from Beirut is the lack of a strategy. I would say this catches you very much. You feel that there is not a master plan, there is no very clear regulations, and that of course gives the form to the city. And the other things that you always surprise is that you are confused on defining the urban spaces. There are a lack of urban spaces. I'm not saying that there are not urban spaces, but not in the traditional way. The urban spaces is the street, are the cafes, are the hidden places, but not like we imagine in the European city, where you have places where people can meet, people can talk, can exchange their ideas. And probably this is also an issue about this city, to create more of these spaces in order to have a deeper exchange of opinions in the right way.
Okay, so moving to the two Lebanese designers, I mean, Nabil and Youssef. I mean, what does it mean learning from Beirut?
What Beirut can give you designing today, contemporary architecture? I mean, you have ultras, people will say, yeah, so.
Je vais parler en français. Donc, ok. En fait, ce qui est fort à Beirut, c'est que elle libère les énergies individuelles. Et ça, c'est quelque chose qu'il n'y a pas, il n'y a nulle part ailleurs. C'est un pays qui nous transcende en tant qu'individu. Donc, on investit les espaces publics, il y a des espaces de négociation. Il y a des permutations, il y a des flexibilités qui se créent, il y a des scénarios qui s'écrivent, parce que c'est ça qui est intéressant dans un projet, c'est d'écrire, de laisser la liberté aux autres d'écrire des scénarios. Moi, je parle par rapport à l'Europe, où il y a souvent des visions, il y a souvent des parties et qui, de plus en plus, on part vers des sécurités, vers des positions qui vraiment maîtrise, on va dire, gêne les individus. On n'arrive plus à se libérer, à inventer. Et ça, c'est, je pense que c'est ça vraiment. C'est pour ça que Beirut, au fond, tout le monde dit qu'elle est moche, mais elle est belle par les gens qui l'habitent, parce que ils créent. Ils créent, on invente, on change par rapport à l'économie, par rapport à la guerre. Elle est pleine de contrastes. C'est ce qui, on est toujours aux aguets. On ne sait pas qu'est-ce que va devenir demain, et en même temps, il y a une banque qui se fait. Donc, c'est un truc exceptionnel. On voit nulle part ailleurs. C'est-à-dire, et donc, c'est ça qui doit refléter Beirut. C'est ces contrastes, ces espaces de brutalité et de sérénité quand on regarde l'horizon, quand on regarde la mer. C'est en même temps un pays dynamique. Et en même temps, un pays serein, quand on vraiment on se tourne dans la mer, vers la mer, c'est un pays qui nous prend, parce qu'il y a une énergie incroyable qui nous laisse rêver et qui libère vraiment les énergies individuelles. Je pense que c'est ça sa force et c'est ça qu'il faut garder et qu'il faut pas avoir honte de dire qu'on n'a pas d'urbanisme ou qu'on n'a pas de, mais il y a des projets qui vont chercher l'espace public, qui vont travailler avec les gens socialement. Donc, on a beaucoup de choses aussi à apprendre à l'Europe et au reste du monde.
Donc, je continue en français, que pour moi, c'est un peu plus simple. Mon connaissance de Beirut, c'est très récente, non? Mais peut-être si je dois faire une référence à la ville, je crois que Beirut, à la fin, c'est simplement une ville ouverte, je dirais, non? C'est une ville ouverte parce que je crois que et bien sûr, c'est géographiquement, c'est clair, c'est ouvert à la mer, mais cet esprit d'ouverture, il revient après sur l'hospitalité de la gente, non? Donc, il a quelque chose à faire aussi avec cette idée de cette terrible ou très fort contraste qu'il existe dans la ville, mais que c'est pour ces raisons, parce que c'est une ville, pour moi, et ça c'est un peu mon impression de ces jours, capable de comprendre les différences. Et donc ça c'est incroyable, il fait la ville avec beaucoup d'énergie, mais il crée aussi cette sorte de contrastes qui sont tout à fait fascinantes, non? Donc cette idée d'ouverture aussi, il a quelque chose qu'à voir, il a en relation avec la manière que les gens vivent dans la ville. Il a beaucoup de cette manière de vivre la roue, non? Un peu comme à Barcelone, qu'on donne toute la Méditerranée, non? Et donc, dans cette ouverture, je crois que c'est la chose la plus sophistiqué qu'il y a dans la ville, non? Donc quelque chose de très simple, très direct, très clair, mais qui génère toute cette contraste, cette sombre aussi, qu'ils font de Beyrouth, pour moi, quelque chose de véritablement intéressant. En fait, les premiers jours qu'on est arrivé, Raya, il a dit que dans cette visite, nous devrons tomber amoureux de Beyrouth, et je crois que c'est quelque chose que peu à peu, il peut devenir.
So it's very interesting because we are all talking about mostly energy and people and environment, and no one is talking about space. This is very interesting. And talking about the fact that we are here, you have been here also asked to design a public space, not something which is also a place to work in, but also at the same time a space which will be a new form of public space. And all of you as a designer in the last year did some of your most important work designing public spaces. I would like to move, let's say, from Beirut to a wider vision to discuss what does it mean today working on a space for a changing community. The community is no more the place where people speak only one language, has the same idea of time, space, and smell and characteristics. Cities are complex overlapped layers, and different people are living in the same place in a completely different way. So what does it mean today, designing a space for publics, a space for a community? I would like to ask to Farshid Moussavi, for example, because I mean the theme of communitarian space is something on which you have been working a lot. So also coming out from Beirut, I mean, would you give us your vision about what does it mean for a designer to work on the idea of publicness in the next years?
So, as a kind of a response to you, is that we often think of public space as outdoor space, yeah, as open space, but a lot of our public spaces are actually inside buildings. You know, we our libraries are public spaces, and you know, our shopping malls in a way are also public spaces, and our museums are public spaces. So I think public space becomes a lot more concrete as a subject to talk about when we situate it in a particular place, because then we can design it in a specific way and we can talk more concretely about what that space can do for the public. So, for example, libraries, you mentioned, you know, libraries used to be a place where you would go and pick up a book to read. But now, because our cities are full of, you know, a mobile community, you know, people who come from other cities to work there, to study there, etc., they go to libraries actually to find friends. We also are increasingly in need of retooling ourselves in terms of knowledge. We used to go to university, finish, and think that that's it, we know it all, we just have to work now. And of course, reality keeps changing and we have to keep learning, and we go to libraries to, again, retool ourselves. So libraries have become something entirely different, and therefore their composition of spaces as a public space, I would say, has entirely changed. And I think it's important to not to think of public space in this vague way. It doesn't mean that we don't need open spaces, but even open spaces, you know, we used to go perhaps in open space and just relax. Now many of us go with our mobiles and kind of laptops and also work. So what we do in open space has changed. And I think it's a fascinating and rich, actually, territory for all of us as architects to investigate.
So it's very interesting. In a way, we are going out of the box. No? In the 21st century is a moment where all the common worlds must be reconsidered completely. So what we consider public spaces, or the word city, the word house, is changing completely because we are facing completely new phenomena which are reshaping the space we are living. So I was wondering, when we were talking, I was thinking a few months ago when meeting some of the offices, we went to Oslo, and we went to visit the National Theatre, and it was early morning, more or less,
And there were some group of schools working on the roof, like a fantastic open space. You know? The roof became a square. And the square on the top of the building, on the top of the roof, was looking at the old town, giving you an amazing view of the city of Oslo. And then I remember another visit I did at the 9/11 Museum, where it's another public space which is related to tragedy. So it's a place where, you know, the tragedy of history and at the same time the memory of something which is difficult to pick has been transformed into something public. So, coming from your experience, what does it mean working in a public space today?
Okay, I think the word public space is a word that we're using more and more and more. I don't think we're really thinking very hard about what public space really means. I agree. Interior spaces, private spaces, more intimate spaces, we should be looking much wider than the traditional idea of public space. So we like to call it messy space, space where you have low thresholds, everyone can go there, there's no program. I think that's probably the most important thing about the roof of the opera, and also there's no program. No one's going to sell you anything there. Things happen there because people go there, and things happen where people meet. So I think this idea of non-programmed space is important. The Oslo Opera House is a huge space. It's certainly transformed Norwegians' ideas about how you meet and how you meet in the city. Norwegians hate cities, really, so we gave them a bit of nature, and they love it, and they meet in the nature. New York is very different because of the tragedies. Here in Beirut, the public space, I think, is all about the small, intimate spaces. And you already have them, and you already use them, but they could be used and looked after much better. There's so many small spaces, small corners that people can take over and use. I think that's where Beirut can work with its public space. It's all over the city. It's not one big formal plaza or a square. It's a very different sort of feel. I think in the 21st century, public space needs to be interactive. You need to actually interact with that space in some way. It's not something you give to people. It's something people actually take and use. And that's the way we like to think of public space, as active, not passive.
May I ask, Bjarke, I mean, talking about public spaces and workspaces, I remember one of the of your first project was a fantastic roof which became an arena, which became a common place, which became a schoolyard, which became everything. And then this roof became house, public housing, where you have the street on the 6th, 10th floor. And now you are, so the idea of publicness was completely reconsider between privacy and living together, exchanging experiences. And now you are dealing with the Google campus, which the first render you see around are mainly, apparently it's not a workspace, but you see situation where experience can happen. So going through this experience, also I think that this experience of Google has been in a way influenced by what you did in the last 15 years. What does it mean working on spaces of a common experience, you know, as we said now?
I mean, specifically with the Google campus, it's dealing with this sort of notion that the urban tissue that characterizes Silicon Valley and basically all of the little towns of Silicon Valley is that they all have almost a binary relationship, that there's a city, like in the case of Google, it's Mountain View. And if you look at sort of downtown Mountain View with the two main streets, it has the same size as the Google campus. And so, you know, Cupertino has Apple, you know, so every single city has a corporate campus that has roughly the same size as the main town itself. Plus, those campuses are actually growing in size. So, the notion of the corporate campus being sort of a self-contained entity shut off from the surroundings won't really work. Because then they're gonna kill the cities. So, in a way, as those campuses get bigger and bigger, they actually have to become urban. They have to include housing. They have to include retail, kindergartens, you know, social infrastructure, the entire thing. And in that sense, the project we're working on is in a way trying to provide this sort of diversity of programs within within a space. Like one thing I was thinking about when Robert was talking about messy space and this like unprogrammed is that and I think which is maybe relevant in the case of Beirut because we're of course like right outside our hotel there's a mosque that I understand is very recently built, but it's right next to a church. And maybe it's a wrestling match between the two, but it could also be, you know, seen as an icon of a potential for harmony or tolerance. And I think one way to make things open is to assign them to no one. But the other way of doing it is to assign them to everyone. And I think like one of our a project we did in Copenhagen is located in the most ethnically diverse neighborhood of all of Denmark. There was Denmark had this Muhammad cartoon crisis where a provincial newspaper hired some cartoonists to show that in the name of freedom of speech you could make fun of everyone, including the Prophet Muhammad. Of course, pissing off 1 billion Muslims worldwide, including the locals from this neighborhood. So there was like some unrest. So when we got invited to do this project, we thought we have to find a way to create ownership among everybody. So we basically reached out to the local community via different channels, social media, physical meetings, and had everybody recommend elements from their other home country. So you have this sort of extreme scenario where you have like a Japanese octopus for playing right next to a Moroccan fountain, right next to actually Chinese palm trees that can grow in a cold climate like Denmark, because they're from the same climate zone, but in China. And you actually have like two Palestinian girls suggested to bring some soil from Palestine. So one of the hills is made out of Palestinian soil, and right next to it you have some manhole covers from Tel Aviv. So you have these sort of extreme contrast, but somehow successfully cohabiting the same space, but giving every single ethnicity a sense of ownership. And I think Beirut has all the ingredients and is already a display of this kind of tolerance, but it could be an interesting design strategy to almost find ways to radically cohabit urban space and architectural expressions.
Well, I completely agree with you that from this point of view, Beirut is a fantastic city of hope. And it shows that nowhere in the Middle East in this moment that it's possible. And this is fantastic, and it's shown through spaces. Places and the communities living together. And this is part of the history of this place and its uniqueness. That's why we're talking about the Beirut as urban lab. No? It's not only physical, it's symbolical, it's social, it's cultural. So talking about traditions and symbols, going back to Japan, what does it mean for, you know, every time the discussion is how it's possible to bring the persons of a far away and to deal and to interpret such a specific culture. So how was, from the Japanese point of view, I know you're not perfectly Japanese, but you are coming from there, your face of 20 hours flight shows very well. So how was, from Tokyo point of view, let's say, the perception of this city and its uniqueness and working on a public space for it?
I mean, for us, as you may know, so I come from Lebanon, so
yeah,
it was a good mix. It was a good mix between a Lebanese point of view and a Japanese point. Yeah, so it was a really mix of points of views, like me coming from here with the experience I have from here, and then Kengo, Kuma and the team from Japan with a totally different point of view. So at the end, it was really an exchange, and it was really, we saw the place as a place of exchange, a place of sensitivities, a place to enable these sensitivities, and a place to really trigger the unexpected. So a place of social interaction, bringing back a sense of place, and then trying to bring back everything that used to be there in a very like new contemporary manner, using also the materiality of the place, the street, which everything happens in the street basically, because the sense of public space is like encapsulated within the street. And some similarities between Japan and Lebanon is exactly this lack of public squares, for example. In Japan, there's this the notion of public square doesn't really exist. The park is something very important there. So the park, for example, in Japan is a safe haven. Whenever you have an earthquake, you always need a park around where there's no buildings around so people can stay there and nothing will collapse. So that's a very different way of using public space, and especially using a different way of using the square, in a way. So basically, that was the mix.
And Nabil, what does it mean, working on Beirut, considering the consideration we did now on the idea of apartments, the idea of public space? You know, we know that Beirut is many Middle East city as a completely different, let's say, national relation to the idea of public spaces. So what do you mean for you, consider interpreting the idea of publicness in a city like Beirut? What do you think Beirut needs to work on public?
Well, I feel Beirut is a bit like an onion with so many layers that you keep peeling, and I'm not going to talk about the garbage management issue, okay? I apologize to our guests that we have a bit of a mishap there. But anyway, I'm a bit like the people around this table in the sense that I left when I was 12. I came back when I was 33. So it was a complete discovery. And the last 20 years have been about peeling that onion and understanding the paradoxes. And I think there are lots of interesting things that have been said over there about the public space, the way you use it, unexpected appropriation. We have a very ancient place. We have a history of cohabitation that goes over 10 centuries. And before that, we've been invaded by so many people. We've been washed over by so many things. But we're still somehow standing up and in a way, it reminds me of this ad that for a beer in Andalusia, where I spent part of my time, which says Andalusia is its people. So I think in a way, Beirut is its people, and they will work with any space or any situation and adapt. But perhaps it could be done better. And unfortunately, the mechanisms of urban planning and urban design and administration, which has other bigger problems to deal with, perhaps not, maybe these are pretty big, does not dedicate a lot, does not have the ability, it seems, to dedicate. And we have antiquated laws, and we have a system of voting, we're lacking a president, I mean, we have a variety of things that have been handicapping our ability to create more meaningful spaces that are open to the public. There are a few examples, they're quite funny, they can check you up before you enter, make sure you're suitable for the space, otherwise you're going to start camping and selling thermos or whatever it is. I mean, we have been fighting with some developers over the use of the roofs of our buildings, or over the, we open spaces to the public and then they get sort of closed or controlled in such a way that you're meant to feel uncomfortable if you were to linger. There are all these uncomfortable issues that are hard to address frontally, and we're trying often. But that has brought me to one conclusion amidst different things, which is that today the architect and his client, developer, public, private, whatever, a bank even better, are finding themselves at a crossroad where they really are the ones that can still make the difference. Our public spaces are mostly private, or there are roads, like we said, or restaurants, potentially malls. We have a lot of malls. These are very successful. But generally, our private initiative is the one that makes a difference. When I came to Lebanon and I did my first project, I had never built something really on my own, under my own flag. It was a little building in Jemaisi. It was on a small plot of land of 500 meters, and it had another 200 meters in front of it, where people used to pee and throw garbage. Okay, I mean, it's on Pasteur Street, and it was for a shipping company. It took me quite a bit of energy and the candor and sort of generosity of my client, so we did the 200 meters as part of our scheme. They didn't belong to him, they belonged to some leftover of the municipality, impossible to acquire. Well, somehow, because of the Lebanese always want to better whatever their neighbor has done, there is a certain will forward.
Well, it sort of impacted within a couple of years all the immediate environment. It was only paving it, putting a couple of olive trees. I'm talking about simple things like that that can become more sophisticated. But if you embrace what's around you, sometimes it's a very small percentage. But everybody benefits. The building benefited, the users benefited, the safety of the area benefited, and obviously the company that was building that and paying for it got the best reward because it was exemplary, people looked up to it, etc., etc. So I do think as architects, sometimes engineers, because engineers do quite a few buildings in Lebanon as well, we should contribute our bit and push forward. So that is how I see public space growing sort of like a mushroom all over the city and covering extensively all the bits and pieces that I think Robert was talking about, all the nooks and crannies.
Well, I think it's very important. You said something I think making a difference. I mean, a good architecture makes a difference, but sometimes a good architecture and bad architecture has the same cost. So this gives a very important role and value to the awareness of the architect and of the clients, because it's a game, it's a common game. And making a difference means designing something which can be perceived by people as a common good, something for everybody. And you feel that it's a good example, it's a common good, this makes a difference, because the people then start to take care of it. Mm-hmm. And the power today of good examples is so powerful, it's so political. And we need political arts. Doing architecture is doing politics, it's good politics. And I truly believe that we should use again this kind of words. I mean, it's not a question of ideology, but it's a question of being generous in relation to the environment we are working. So my last question is, what does it mean improving this word,
this big word we are always using, quality, through design? What does it mean designing quality? What does it mean putting through design process the idea of quality in the everyday life through our work, your work? Who wants to? Youssef.
Moi, j'aimerais revenir deux secondes sur l'espace public, parce que, en fait, la définition pour moi de l'espace public, c'est le lien entre l'individu et une vision de la société. Et ça, c'est très important. Ça veut dire qu'il faut qu'il y ait une vision qui nous représente. Quand on rentre dans un endroit, il ne faut pas qu'on se sente brimé. Il ne faut pas qu'il y ait des symboles qui nous offensent. Il ne faut pas qu'il y ait des choses dans lesquelles on ne croit pas. Donc, et il faut en même temps, on se sent libre de transgresser l'espace, de le vivre, d'écrire des scénarios. C'est ça, à mon avis, le propre d'un espace public. Et même s'il se transforme d'un public, d'un espace ouvert à un espace fermé. Ce qui est important dans un programme, c'est que de laisser toujours des gaps pour que l'individu puisse s'exprimer, puisqu'il puisse inventer son propre scénario. Et en même temps, il faut qu'il se sente à l'intérieur. Bien, c'est un espace qui accepte les différences. Je pense que c'est ça l'intérêt d'un espace public, parce que c'est un espace d'échange, c'est un espace qui relie. Il ne faut pas qu'il fasse des ségrégations. Et c'est pour ça qu'on voit que la plupart des espaces publics qui fonctionnent en ce moment, c'est des grands paysages. On voit, nous, chez nous, Rauché, on voit le Hyde Park, parce que c'est des espaces qui dépassent le symbole et qui dépasse le côté politique et sociétal des gens. Et c'est pour ça qu'il faut les reproduire, essayer de les reproduire dans des bâtiments, se tourner vers la mer, se tourner vers des plateaux qui sont au-delà du symbole et notre capacité, si je reviens juste par rapport à ce qu'il disait Marc sur le Japon, notre capacité, c'est, on a la même force. Ce qui m'a intrigué dans le Japon, c'est comment ils arrivent à trouver des interstices et à les habiter. Ils inventent des programmes. C'est-à-dire qu'ils y a, par exemple, 5 mètres de large sur 20 mètres de long. Ben, ils vont pas dire non, on peut rien faire parce que l'administration, parce que le règlement, parce que... Non, ils vont inventer un espace, un restaurant qui fait 5 mètres par 20 mètres de long. Et c'est ça le propre, quand je parlais des idées individuelles, c'est ça. C'est de réinventer, de se réinventer toujours. C'est ça qui me paraît important. Après, je réponds rapidement à ta question de qualité. de toute façon, quand on travaille avec le privé, c'est toujours le client. Et c'est toujours le client qui donne cette qualité ou pas. C'est-à-dire que c'est lui qui décide si son projet va au-delà d'un projet économique et si son projet devient un projet politique, sociétal, et qui lui renvoie de nouveau autre image, autre confiance. C'est-à-dire il faut que le client se représente aussi. Et nous, on dépend du client. Vous savez, Zumthor, il a dit, un bon projet, c'est un bon client. En fait, c'est très simple. On ne peut pas faire les choses seul. Donc, bien sûr, la qualité est importante. Parce que quand on a... Mais en même temps, il ne faut pas que la qualité brime les individus. C'est ça la limite qui est très importante dans un projet.
Based on my sort of relatively pedestrian understanding of French, I heard the mention of the significance of the client in the creation of quality in architecture. I actually think that I like to sort of consider this, because architects never design for ourselves, or rarely. Like, we mostly design for someone else who has like very specific needs and concerns and demands and criteria, and therefore I like this idea that architects are more like midwives, that we sort of assist the city or like an institution or like a family in giving birth to their building or their public space, and in that sense there is something a little bit disturbing about the architectural competition, because you know, if you are like a family expecting, you have your first meeting with the midwife, and then it's as if the midwife then goes away for 3 months and then comes back with your baby, and that's not how babies are born, I've been told. So I think there's I tend to see that also where the process becomes more of an adventure for us is when this the possibility of immersion happens, and that happens through dialogue, and it happens through like putting things forward and getting unexpected responses, and then gradually something evolves, a design and an idea emerges, and I think I don't know how to organize it differently, but that's the one thing that the competition as a format lacks, and therefore it often becomes a little bit fire and forget, and sometimes the boldest idea will have a hard time winning, or even have a hard time being sort of suggested. And I think some of the craziest buildings we've done, we've actually done them in collaboration with a client that you would normally imagine would be a way to, like, traditionally that would be like the client like chopping you down until there's like nothing left. But actually, when you have the direct dialogue, instead of encountering all these parameters as opposition, they become drivers of the design, and suddenly you can go a more crazy route. Then maybe also like one last thing on quality. I got a t-shirt from my friends Claes and Koivist and Rune, the Swedish architects. It says, if you think good architecture is expensive, then try bad architecture.
I think that Farshid and Moussavi want to add something, because I mean, it's on the microphone. Sorry.
Quite loud by itself. I think some of what Bjarke has said is right, but I think that the midwife analogy is wrong. Because I can tell you from my experience, I have had a child, and midwives don't do anything. And I think the difference between an architectural project and a child is that miraculously children, I mean, like, nature and our body follows this kind of biological process, and really neither the midwife nor the mother can very much do anything. I mean, it's a miracle that things just happen, and fortunately, rarely they go they go unexpected kind of directions. Now, I think architectural projects are completely crafted. And it's true that there are many agents involved, many players, many forces, and they're very unpredictable. And that's why they're very interesting and we love to do them. But I think the architect plays a massive role in actually being an activist in that process and shaping the kind of the direction of the project. You know, if you didn't have the architect, then you know, all projects would kind of turn either into chaos or very formulaic. I think a good architect is the one who is there to steer, to find a kind of an interesting cut through all these diverse things that are brought into a project. And this is where politics enters. You mentioned politics. I think it's probably micropolitics rather than politics. But every project plays its own, has the potential of being micropolitical. You know, you have an architectural competition and you get 8 different versions. Why? Because we take a part in that equation. You know, our client has given us information. We've come here to be inspired by Beirut, etc. But we all come with different proposals, and that's because we play a part. So I don't think we should use the word midwife.
I just want to say, like, I clearly don't have the traumatic experience with midwives as you do yet. So I don't know if some of our friends would want something about the idea of court. Well, Robert, yeah.
Well, I'm not going to get involved in the midway.
Midwife crisis.
We can talk about that later.
Boss, mid-process.
I think quality is an interesting idea. I think it's often not always what you do, but how you do it. That makes a difference. And certainly if we're talking about public ownership, then it's really how you do it that is all important. So process is everything. If you don't have a good process, you won't have a good building and people won't like it. End of story. Every building you have to do. You should design the process before you start designing the building.
Some of you want to, Fabrizio, want to add something about that?
La qualité d'un projet, souvent c'est quelque chose un peu inexplicable, non? Donc il y a des bonnes architectures, des architectures de qualité faites de la plus différente manière, non? Et donc peut-être la chose que pour moi il est encore très important, il a un valeur très important, c'est encore en fait la capacité d'invention, que la petite capacité d'invention que comme architecte on a, la capacité de transformer la capacité d'un client de son recours, son moyen en quelque chose de plus intégrale, qui offre une manière de vivre l'espace, une manière de vivre la ville, peut-être différente, non, plus complexe. Et donc, dans cette capacité de transformation de les choses, de transformation de la capacité, de la gestion aussi des de recours d'un client, d'envisager quelque chose de, on peut dire, surprenant parfois, non, quelquefois. Et peut-être là, c'est où réside la qualité d'un projet, qu'il n'y a rien à voir, il a rien à voir avec les moyens, avec l'économie, avec les programmes ou différentes choses, non. Donc, dans ce petit espace d'invention, je crois que c'est l'espace de la qualité pour moi.
Yeah, fortunately we don't have a specific recipe. I mean, it's always a matter of reaction of different elements playing together, which create this something which is became kind of magic, no? How people, I mean, sometimes I always say designers should come back to the place they design to see how the people can teach them how they are using the space. Because the way people, and in a way, architecture create a kind of pact of citizenship, no? Because a good architecture ground and allow new habits. And the idea of citizenship between new architecture and people is so important, because today we need to root, you know, architecture into a new way of living it.
You just mentioned, you know, architects should go back, suggesting that they don't.
Yeah, yeah. That's,
well, I don't think that's true.
Ah, okay.
Well, I mean, going back to baby analogies, you know, I think of the projects I've worked on as my babies, and I go back to visit them. You know, Yokohama finished, 12 years ago, whatever. I am there at least every other year. Out of my own will.
And so
I go to visit it to see how it has evolved. The Museum of Contemporary Art in Cleveland that finished 5 years ago, I have been. You know, whenever I'm in the US, I try to go to see how it has evolved, how they are reacting to the way people have embraced it, etc. I think, and I'm sure I'm not.
No. Yeah, sure. Not all of them. I know some.
So what
do Yokohama taught you?
I think I was, in fact, just walking here. I was telling Bjarke that, for example, when you specify building materials, you think 12 years, you know, because that's, you are, as an architect, you are at the mercy of, you know, the industry.
Yeah.
And they give certain warranties, and most materials are specified for 12 years. And at the time, you think, oh, it's a long time, but it passes like anything. And Yokohama has passed over the threshold, and, you know, it has had to go through a kind of a maintenance, the wood, etc. I don't know what an architect can kind of do other than, I guess, work with more hard-wearing material. Yeah. But then it would be sad if we all had to use stone for every surface, no. And etc. But I think you learn. You learn how to also introduce materials. I think I've been very interested in seeing how people have kind of reacted to the plaza. Whenever I see pictures of it on the internet, I'm always archiving them, because
yeah.
It's more interesting people's photo of the building than my photo of the building, because it's kind of seeing it through their lens. And I am sure everyone on this panel feels the same.
That's for sure. That's why we are here.
Yes.
So thank you so much. And I know that they told me that a lot of students want to give ask questions, and so we have 10, 15 minutes, no more, for good questions. Good questions, please. All the questions are always very good, you know. And so please give your name and the school and to whom you addressed the question. So who wants? So who's the first? You have no more than 10 minutes. But they told me that to have the cocktail, you have to make questions. So without questions, at least 5-10 questions, we cannot enjoy the. Okay, cool. Over there, it's difficult. Can you stand up and shout? Shout, it's okay. Passing, I can see it. Yeah, okay. So,
good evening. My name is Yamin. I'm not a student, so I'm not.
Welcome as well.
My question is
to whom?
Open to whoever wants to answer. Like, we were talking all the evening about the open spaces and public spaces. And it's good to think about the essence of this question. But here, in the context of Beirut, we have seen a lot of buildings like that were built in the modern period or now, like the the campus, USG campus of Youssef, Tohme and Sonnet Architect, that they like tried to do this, but we see now that it's closed and it's difficult to go to enter.
To get in, yeah.
Yeah, the public space and it's building for non-students of the USG. Same for the end of Martin Marie. It was designed to be an open space and public space. And, so how can you prevent this? So it's good to design something, but how can you, in the context of Beirut, I mean, how can you make it work?
It's a fantastic question. Joseph.
Ouais. En fait,
it's your fault.
Non, parce que en fait, c'est d'où l'importance du client. C'est-à-dire que c'est vrai, on vit dans un pays qui il y a la sécurité, c'est en face de la sécurité générale, donc c'est assez difficile. Il faut contrôler. C'est pour ça qu'il faut proposer des espaces publics qui permettent ça. Après, ça vous échappe. Après, c'est le client qui décide. Mais il faut le permettre. Et c'est là. C'est là que, à mon avis, si je reviens par rapport à ta question de qualité, il faut qu'une architecture prenne un risque. Il faut que le client prenne un risque, qu'elle pose des questions. Nous, on a posé des questions. On a essayé, en tout cas, de poser des questions, de laisser des endroits où on prend le temps de s'asseoir. On n'en a plus le temps. Tout le monde bouge dans tous les sens, plus personne ne réfléchit. Moi, ce qui m'intéresse, c'est que toi, tu penses, pas moi, je pense à ta place. Et c'est ça qui m'intéresse. C'est pour ça que l'architecture, elle peut fabriquer ça, elle peut provoquer ça, mais après, elle t'échappe. Après, de toute façon, elle t'échappe. Moi, j'écoute Farshid et je sais ce qu'elle ressent. Quand elle revient, elle voit... Moi, je reviens toujours à l'ULJ et à chaque fois, je souffre, sincèrement. Je souffre parce que je vois comment il le ferme, comment il. Mais c'est pas faute d'essayer.
Juste pour ajouter quelque chose, je suis totalement d'accord avec la réflexion de Youssef. Je crois que peut-être c'est quelque chose pour répondre à ta question, que cette idée de ouverture de l'espace public qui échappe un peu à notre capacité. Non? Et peut-être c'est une réflexion qu'il doit faire pas seulement les architectes, mais aussi les clients privés, et sur l'importance de récupérer une vocation civique et publique aussi de l'espace privé. Et donc, je crois que peut-être cette réflexion, c'est énormément importante ici en Beyrouth. Non?
Ouais.
Et aussi, on a fait beaucoup de réflexions aussi dans les concours sur cette thématique. Donc, je crois que la responsabilité de modifier ou d'avancer dans cette ouverture, on peut dire, de l'espace public, il revient beaucoup aussi sur les clients. Non? Nous, comme architectes, on peut aider, non? Mais récupérer la vocation civique de l'espace privé, c'est quelque chose, on peut dire, que nous, on peut aider. Mais c'est une modification, je crois, culturelle de la société qu'il doit être fait et qui peut-être peut aider à supérer cette difficulté, non, qu'il y a ici.
Yeah, I completely agree on the idea of this ambiguity within what is public today, which is mainly is owned by private. So it's this gives the centrality to the one who owns the space and they can allow the space to be alive. I remember when Georges Arbid shows us the beautiful drawings of the Electricité de Liban and this amazing vision of this space which was empty, looking the sea and the ground floor which was an open plaza, and every time I pass by I saw it abandoned. I feel it's so sad, but at the same time the space is there. The space is there, it can be open. I mean, you can open the gate, you can use it again. I mean, the space allowed to be lived again. No, it's not. So now it's really a matter of a choice, of choice of who owns this space, which is a common goods. So it can be something which came back to life, just opening a door. No, so this is always very important, and architecture has this amazing power. It's there. So it's a matter of the one who can open the door or not. So I think this is one of the elements for George.
I'm not a student, but I think I had around 200 or 300 between here and outside, so it's okay. What I want to say is that I'm extremely happy to see this huge crowd interested in debating about architecture. We are in a city that was rebuilt without any debate. And I claim that it's never too late to open debates like these ones, either with renowned architects or debating among each other about the future of our cities. So I'm very thankful for the bank to have organized this as much as having organized the competition. I think that this debate is as important as the building itself. Thank you.
Thanks, George. So, another question? Okay. Voilà.
Good evening. My name is Eliane Arar. I am a student at Holy Spirit University of Isaac, and this is my fifth year of architecture. I have a question because Farshid talked about something that a building should be actually crafted, but is it possible to achieve perfection in a building, or is it always every time you visit the building you feel that something should change or something should be a bit different, because we are in a society that evolves all the time, and is it it's basically impossible for a student to achieve perfection in the building that we are creating, because we focus on the process, we focus on the urban landscape or the urban city that we are actually trying to build in. But it's always evolving, so it's a question for all of you. Is it possible to achieve perfection in a building?
Fragility of perfection. Yeah, please.
I don't remember using the word crafted, but I think that the word crafted doesn't mean perfection. And crafted doesn't necessarily mean only the physical fabric of a building. Buildings are also ideas. Buildings are organization. You know, there are many different auditorium shapes. This one gives us this tier and then another lot that are seeing from above. Other auditoriums will bring, you know, a few hundred people in a different way together. So the word craft, I think, it doesn't mean just about physical materials. You know, buildings are far richer and broader than that. But about the idea, the problem of whether it's you or just contemporary architects, and the fact that we work within a sea of change constantly. I'm sure you will. People have different ways of responding to it, but one way to think about it is keep a certain level of openness in buildings. It needs to be elastic somehow. It needs to be robust enough so that it would somehow cope with unforeseen changes. But there will always be a limit to it. And you know, buildings should also be able to be pulled down if they are no longer relevant to our needs. We should not think that buildings are there necessarily to last forever. Maybe the physical fabric lasts, but maybe our lives change at some point so long that the office building that we designed one day is too shallow, doesn't have enough light, doesn't have the right systems. So I think that, you know, we should not burden ourselves with the responsibility to absolutely account for every change in the future. We cannot.
Thank you.
Hi, over here. Nabil mentioned that public space is very synonymous with the private sector in this country. So my question is, I feel like every time the private sector gives a public space, it expects of it to generate money or generate income. My question is, do you feel that there is this expectation of this project, because Marnhai is a buzzing area that basically is filled with pubs that people spill out on the street. So is the public space of this project a gift to the city, or rather a tool to generate money?
That's a question for you.
Well,
I don't know. You?
If you address me, I'll start at least. I think that's a question for the owners of the project, technically. But I must say that often, and I think that's what's sort of cool about Lebanon, is it's not always directed to immediate income. Maybe it has a positive return because you integrate in your community and they will come and want to bank with you, just to give an example. But I don't think this is something that is necessary or indispensable for, in this case, for the bank. It is more just to contribute to a place that is already contributing to its prosperity. So I have seen projects where really you were giving public space just so that you would offer something in return for something that was already there. And the fact that it does generate some benefit is common to almost anywhere in the world. I remember in the 80s when the town hall in New York was really pushing and giving what was called incentive zoning. You could get up to 20% more buildable area in exchange of doing a covered passage between lots. Or, and if you remember at that time, there was an IBM lobby with its bamboos or whatever. And these were highly controlled public spaces. They were public as long as the owner wanted them to be public. They could kick you out at any time. There were beautiful bronze plaques on the floors that said that if you loitered or left a paper or something, you could be in trouble. So that's perhaps, you're putting your finger on a crux of a problem, is that in many European or Western countries that I know and others, public space is provided by the public government, by the system, which means it is less conditional no matter what. We are here sort of quite happy and lucky to take what we're being offered, which is provided by the private, as the rest of the system doesn't seem to be in shape to offer more. But I don't think it's for direct profit. I doubt that from what I see.
Attends, en fait, tu peux penser qu'un espace public, par exemple, regarde Beaubourg, quand c'est ouvert, ça a ouvert, tu peux imaginer des espaces, des gens n'ont même pas l'argent d'acheter les journaux. Ils allaient pour lire les journaux. Ça ne coûte rien à la banque. Les journaux, ils sont là tous les jours. Il y a des gens qui peuvent venir s'asseoir, regarder, lire les journaux, regarder la mer. Ni ça coûte à la banque, ni ça coûte à la personne de faire ça. C'est ça l'esprit, je pense, d'un espace public qui est privé. C'est d'avoir cette latitude, avoir inventé des choses que les gens, par exemple, à Internet, que les gens peuvent venir regarder. Il y a des gens qui n'ont pas Internet, qui peuvent venir regarder, faire des recherches. C'est dans ce sens qu'un espace public peut marcher sans argent. Et c'est des expériences qui sont un peu partout, quand tu regardes la HSBC à Tokyo, je crois, je sais plus, Hong Kong, le rez-de-chaussée, il est investi. Quand tu vois la nouvelle tour de piano, au-dessus, il y a des jardins, tu peux remonter, ça ne coûte rien. Donc c'est un peu un mélange des deux qu'il faut, à mon avis, pour que l'espace public soit réussi, c'est les deux. Parce que Beaubourg vraiment reste un exemple d'intégration et de... Voilà.
Just want to... I just wanted to add some one thing to this discussion to the public space, which is very interesting. And there's another issue about the creation of public space, because here we talk about a client with a vision that is suggesting to make a building where that has also a place that a public space that is related with the neighborhood, which is, I mean, of course, the right way. But there's also an issue that sometimes we don't have to wait that the a good client or the city creates public spaces, but we should try as a citizen to try to get conquest. Conquer the spaces. I mean, we are the citizens are the one that have to create somehow the public spaces by the use. You can make a beautiful squares or beautiful areas, but I think that there is the need, especially in cities like Beirut, as I was saying, that for somehow are very similar to some Italian cities that had the same process. We had beautiful public spaces that were in the 70s, in the 80s, used by, as a parking. So that the car became like the main user of the streets, of the squares, and the spaces were gone. But there has been a process, for example, also in Milan is going on, that this idea of the cars are the main actor of the city start to change, and that we have to take out the cars, take out this parking areas, and try to get back the spaces that we lost in the cities. And I see that happening, for example, in Milan in the last years, and I see it as a very interesting changes. And it happens especially when people start to using these spaces, start to try to get back the public spaces. And
my name is Mariam Sultan. My friends and I are studying architecture at the American University of Beirut. Many of you mentioned the use of architecture as an agent of social change. And in our studio this semester, we've been really focusing on the use of materials that are inherently part of Beirut and repurposing them and reusing them and recycling them. And I was wondering how applicable this is to projects that are done at a larger scale. Maybe because it's become really necessary in places, especially like Beirut, to address these immediate social issues through our use of how we make our architecture.
Okay, yeah, of course. I think it should be much more important for us doing larger projects than it is. I think that's going to change. This is something that's developing. We cannot go on building the way we are building. So it is going to change, and we have to be a part of that.
Actually, maybe one thing, I think there's, I mean, of course, like cradle to cradle is an interesting idea, and I think it's especially an interesting idea for consumer products that have a short lifespan, but actually the energy that it takes to put a building together, and there's maybe like some kind of a contrast between that. If you apply this to buildings, it becomes very much about almost like over determining the what you can do, and somehow assuming that in 10 or 20 years that all those systems are still in place, so that all the effort that went into making it upcyclable or whatever, that makes a lot of sense when you're making a cell phone that most likely is decommissioned in a year, it maybe doesn't apply exactly to architecture in the same way. I think it's interesting. There is actually one way that you can make buildings last forever. And I had this sort of eureka moment. I went to Kurdistan before ISIS happened, and I went to the north of Kurdistan where there was. We went to a synagogue, and it was 2,750 years old. and it was a ruin, but it was like the arches were there, there was holes in the roof, there was plants growing, but there was the metalwork was actually still there. It was rusting, but it was still there. So I asked, like, when did it stop functioning as a synagogue? And the answer was, like, in the mid-late 50s, when the state of Israel was opened and the environment in Iraq was becoming inhospitable to Jews. All of the Jews in the village left. So it had actually been fully functional and completely intact for 2,700 years. And the second that the people living in the village stopped caring for it, it turned into a ruin in a matter of decades. And you also, like, you have houses in the Faroe Islands in the Atlantic Ocean that are made entirely out of wood, that are like more than 500 years old. Like, none of the materials can last that long, but as a building, because it's been continuously inhabited and the people living there have cared for it, it still stands. So in that sense, like, the only way a building can last forever is if it remains relevant and loved by the people inhabiting it. So it can change functions, it can change use, it can change everything, but if it remains with an emotional and, of course, and therefore also practical attachment to its local inhabitants, it will last forever. So in that sense, I think in architecture, maybe finding ways where the bones of the buildings we built, and, you know, the creativity that the world puts into finding new functions for beautiful old industrial buildings, even though they're built for brewing beer or warehouses, because they're so nice, the Tribeca lofts or the Soho lofts in New York City, they have more value than some newly built condo, because the bones of the buildings are beautiful.
Yeah, I, as usual, people make the difference. We are doing architecture for people. We are not doing architecture for nothing. So the people is life, is desire, is energy, and what keeps everything alive is at the end the people takes care of it. It's the best renewable material we can consider. The last question. Now, don't stop. Yeah, I know it. So, lady, yes, absolutely.
She already has the microphone.
Yeah, she has the microphone. Who's the microphone? Okay, so another lady. So, sorry. Okay. Sorry.
My name is Rezan Fakhouri. I work in Dar al Hendasa. I'm not a student of food, but I have a question. I've noticed a challenge that I'm facing, and I think so many architects working in big companies especially are facing. It's that not all clients are like the client you have at the moment, which is the van, that's giving you the opportunity and flexibility to do the design you want and put the full input you want in it. Like, so many clients have like certain restrictions and certain demands and so many things that we believe in and we would want to put in our building, wouldn't make as much sense to them as it does for us. So what would you do in a case that the client is not like doesn't see what you see or doesn't value what you value in a building? And especially if there's restrictions like budget or like specific demands, like what would you value more and to what extent would you compromise what you believe?
So let's say seduction versus the worst client ever. So they are all very good in seduction. So who want to talk about seduction and the worst client ever? How to convince it to change idea?
So, seduction. Okay.
Who is like a belly dancer? You know, actors, so that's the belly dancer every time, you know?
I mean, it's true when you come out with like a design that can always try to convince and get the best part of a client. I mean, you'll always try to get as much as you can from him. There's always rounds. I mean, comes and goes. I mean, it's like any other game of seduction, right? So sometimes it's in your camp, sometimes the other camp. But I mean, I guess a good design will always be convincing as a standalone object. It will always bring things to the table that maybe the client wouldn't have thought of, or like something that will bring back something from this, but at the end, I guess it's a tough game. And then when you deal with developers, especially, and they have like a lot of profit in the game, it's always like what you bring to the table and how much you can get from this. And then I guess it's all about the same thing: good design or bad design.
Okay, sorry.
So I think that for tonight, One more. Now everybody's there.
They have the opportunity.
We should be democratic. We have to talk. So one from the up, and then we.
I have a question.
No, wait. I don't see.
Don't jump.
Don't jump, please. And then we continue in the cocktail. So
okay.
It's, we move from public to private.
Okay, my name is Ali Ghaddar. Okay. I have a question, okay, because history is important. At the end of our Lebanese Civil War, we faced an economical crisis, and it was huge, okay? And then in 2008 or 7, maybe we faced also an international economical crisis. And we all remember the protesters in the Wall Street. Nowadays, also in Lebanon, we are struggling in our economy. And we also have a political crisis, a lot of problems. In the means of instability, how this building can possess the aim of publicity?
Wow. So, now how this architecture can address the situation, this actual situation we represent, our architecture, this building could... Yeah. No, well, not instability, I would say, this situation, not necessarily instability. So, Nabil. Look, you do your best.
I think the issue of time is very important. History, obviously, but the issue of time and trying to stick to your beliefs and your values and plan long-term. Just like Bjarke was saying, if you do a loved building, it will last for a long time. So you aim beyond the immediate concerns. It's a bit abstract, but that's what we try to do on a daily basis. I'm sure a lot of people in this room are doing just the same.
Okay, so thank you so much to our guests. Thank you so much to you. We have a cocktail now. Thank you for BLF for this. And hopefully this will be not the last debate. So stay tuned on the final result on the competition and see you upstairs.